To see here on this beautiful Sunday afternoon, and we got a little special edition stream today. We've got the Bob Hatter, Mr. Bob Clark, right below me. Bob, tell us a little bit about yourself.
My real name is Bob Clark, and I got the name the Bob Hatter. Actually, it wasn't from poker. I used to be a political consultant, and when I started in that industry, basically, I don't have the family name. I'm not a Kennedy or a Bush. I don't have an Ivy League degree, and I'm not rich. So I had to do something in that industry to set myself out without buying really fancy suits. So one of my friends in his drunken state suggested I started wearing a hat all the time. And so then I became the Bob Hatter that way. And so what's really great is that whenever you go to those events, people would always wave each other if they saw someone. So instead I would just do a hat tip, actually to show my collection off. There it is. You can see a little bit there.
That's a great collection.
And unfortunately, my mic on my webcam was off, so I couldn't do the whole wear a hat on stream, which really was sad. Very sad day. And so I didn't play poker before pre-Black Friday, but I was a complete and total fish, lost a lot of money then. But basically, the last year, ever since you started streaming, I've really taken my game seriously. Read a lot of books. Actually, I've been going through Chris Morris's book right now. And really taking it seriously. So when I do lose a hand, I analyze and say, why did I lose a hand? Where did I go wrong? Or was it just a cooler? And, you know, I made all the right plays, but still lost the money.
Let's see if we got a good.
Was that good enough?
That was a great introduction. Yeah. Any big names that you were doing political consulting for that we might recognize?
A lot of the times I signed an NDA. So I can't really tell you about all the people that I worked with. I can say I did some very low-level stuff with John McCain's campaign, worked a couple different governor campaigns, but a lot of it where I was playing at was a big there was NDA, so I can't tell you a lot of the clients that I worked with.
Okay.
So actually, here's what I can tell you. Do you remember the SOPA issue?
I do. I do.
So
remember
there was
the
guy who was pushing SOPA was named Lamar Smith.
Okay.
And there was a guy running in his district called Sheriff Mack. I don't remember his first name, but I worked on his campaign, helping him do a lot of the online push to get basically, I told him there's a lot of anger about this guy. So you need to focus your net on fundraising nationwide. And so I was the one who helped him set up his, his Reddit AMA, which raised, I think was about $30,000. Not enough, but so for him, he was stoked. So that's probably the biggest name that I can tell you that I didn't sign an NDA for.
Okay. Sounds good. I think that you should just tell people, oh, yeah, Obama. Obama. I signed an NDA, but between you and me, Obama.
I'll just be honest, it was mainly on the conservative side of things, the campaigns I worked, but it is what it is. Actually, the way I got my teeth cut in that industry was I did petition work. One day, one of my friends came up to me and said, sign this. I'm like, why? It'll make me money. Okay, I don't care then. And so realizing after I did the math in my head of how much money he made, how many I can do an hour, then I started doing that work. And within 3 weeks of running that, I was running half a state.
We just had a little bit of a crash over here live.
Definitely.
We've got no delay today, guys, for a few minutes. We got Ferrari Doctor in the stream coming, watching from the tables at Hollywood Park. It's great to see you, Ferrari. Grateful Malice in the stream, Poker Mindset Coach. We got hashtag Schwagio and HWin. You guys are great. I'm going to tell you guys what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about some HPT. We're going to talk about some staking issues. We're going to talk about Tasty Stakes. And we're going to try to see if we can't all band together and make sure that the Bob Hatter will be representing the Fist Bump crew coming in February for the HPT over at the Golden Gates. Tell us what you want to play, Bob.
The big event I want to play is the main event, the 1651. I was going to play both the opening event and the final events, but you actually told me to only do the big event.
Why did I say that?
You said it because the softness of the field compared to how much money you're putting in is much better in the 1650 event than the 300 event.
Can I see? Let me see it. Let me show him what happened.
My Deathwing lost his toe. Sorry.
Where'd you get this anyway? This was part of BlizzCon, a little show and tell. She had it on the bookshelf. and must have bumped it or something, because Deathwing just lost some hit points right there. You see the little toe right there?
And it was finisher.
Oh.
Stubbed.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So far.
Casualty. Jesus. And then there goes the web camera.
Bummer.
Michelle's just tearing through the room.
Sorry.
Okay, guys. So, basically.
So, real quick, I want to give a shout out to Grateful Mouse. He is the first person to stake me for 10% on the stream.
It's a good bet, Grateful Mouse. It's a good bet. Before you sell out, guys, I don't want you to rush to back Bob yet, because I haven't booked my stake. So let's go through and first I want to talk about the HPT, the Heartland Poker Tour, and I want to talk specifically about the Colorado Stop. Let's look at when it is on the calendar. Let's look at the schedule leading up to the main event. Let's talk about the main event. And then I want to talk about Tasty Stakes, and I want to talk about how you are trying to sell action in this event and why it's a good idea to buy it. And then I want to talk about I want to actually go through the process of booking a piece of you on stream, and then I want to talk about the structure and kind of come up with a little bit of a game plan for when you get into the event, Bob. That's the game plan. After all that's done, we're going to say goodbye to Bob, and we're going to get back to our normal Dutch Boy Poker Show, Season 2, Episode 10 today, where I'm going to be trying to take down that Disneyland tournament. I'm going to be trying to take down the Winter Poker Festival main event and the Reloader. So there's going to be lots of poker action. If you want to watch some play-by-play, hand-for-hand type things, and you're not interested at all in staking or the HPT or talking about the nitty gritty about how we should be changing gears at an HPT tournament, that's fine. Come back in about an hour and we'll be back with a delay. We'll be back to normal. But for now, let's focus on this. Okay. So what I want to do here, we'll get rid of the goldfish in the bowl, which is what you said you were before, years and years ago when you first started playing poker, but not anymore, right, Bob? I mean, you've been working on your game. Tell us a little bit about it.
I entered two different poker leagues in town, and one of the big one, the Friday night one that I'm in, I'm actually right now first in chips out of everyone. So basically the way it works is it's a single table tournament every single week, and you accumulate points, and then those points are chips for the finals. And then after that, basically, depending on how well you do in the final tournament, is if you get a ticket to the WSOP event, one of the $1,500 ones that you get to choose. And also, whoever has first place in chips at the end, regardless of how they do in the finals, they get a stake for a 565 event.
Okay. Now, which league is that? Is that Pike's
That's
Poker League?
That's the Pike's Peak Poker Game.
The Pike's Peak Poker Game, which, correct me if I'm wrong, but you found out about that league through this stream, right?
I did, because we started talking, and you introduced me to J.D. Cole.
Yep.
And he's the one who introduced me to the league and got me into it.
And J.D. Cole has another poker player in his family, Linda Cole, who actually took down the Poker Zero Twitch Poker League. So she's the one who came in, played like four events, won two of them, and took the PlayStation 4 from me and Seattle Pro and Nikki Two Cards and Iceman Kiwi and all the other people who had their eyes set on unboxing the PlayStation 4. Instead, it goes to Linda Cole, who, does she play the league with you guys?
No, she doesn't.
She doesn't.
It's hilarious. She doesn't play poker really at all.
But I'm not laughing, because I really wanted that PlayStation 4. I don't see the humor in it. I think from now on, J.D. Cole should probably stay at home with the kids and send her to go represent the Cole family at the Pike's Peak Poker League games, because she definitely has something going. I mean, like an insane win percentage there. And she played pretty good. I mean, yeah, she got a little lucky, but she also played pretty good. So I was impressed. She took down two events out of 16, and she only played like four of them. So
yeah.
That is the story.
Saying, this is easy. Why can't you guys do better at this?
And we got J.D. Cole actually in the stream. So good to see you, J.D. And I was just clowning you. He goes, okay, let's talk about Bob.
Yep, there we go, yep.
So J.D. Cole introducing Bob to the Pike's Peak Poker League up there in Colorado. Colorado's actually a pretty big market for poker. You don't really think about Colorado as a hot spot for the game that we love, but from what I can tell, that is, you know, it's got a real history of being a center for poker. I mean, it was Colorado where Wild Bill was shot, right? I think.
Yep. I believe so. And actually, if you look at last year's events for the HPT and also the Mid-States Poker Tour, I think their biggest one, or at least their top three, was in Colorado.
I think you're right, too. Every time I've ever talked to the HPT crew or have been talking about the stops that they have, they always rave about how Colorado completely just blows their numbers away and everybody's expectations away. It's a big area with not a lot of poker options, right? So it's like, it's far enough away from Vegas and far enough away from, like San Francisco or L.A. where... The regional poker players don't really travel, so when they do get an event, they all come out for it. You get a lot of people. How many people did they have last year? Do you know?
I think it was over 750, I believe. Let me go double check.
So here it is at Golden Gates. I'm gonna go ahead and check with you. Let me find here. HPT Golden Gates.
They have two events every year. And so you want to look at the first one. The first one, it says here, 761 entrants for this event last year at this time. And then they also have one in September. Last year in September, they had 721.
So both times,
the first place prize was over 225K.
We recognize this guy getting fifth place. Danny Gonzalez, you remember him on that HPT viewing party that we had, Bob Hatter?
I do.
So here he is getting fifth place in the September 4th to 14th event. Total prize pool, $1,059,000. First place at $227,000. Mike Shepsky out of Illinois. You got Rex Klingscales going out for $144,000. A couple people from Florida. So, I mean, if you look at this, if you look at the final table... you got a couple of out-of-towners, right? You got this guy Matt Bond, you got Richard Dixon, Brandon Miller, no one that I really recognize, but then half the table are locals, including Danny Gonzalez, who's from Denver. You got Don Patrick, you got Victor, you got Richard. So five out of the nine, four out of the nine were locals. The other were coming out, and if you look at the results, this is just in September. Not a lot of players that would really recognize. Here's Eddie Sabat coming in 17th. That's, you know, a name. Chris Treba, he's definitely a pros pro, but he's local to Colorado, which is why he's playing. I don't think that he would be playing this event if he wasn't also, you know, if he didn't actually live in Colorado. Stan Jablonski just playing everything because he's always chasing that player of the year, HPT player of the year. Other than that, I mean, I'm looking at the list of runners, and it's pretty, it's just a lot of names I don't recognize, you know, and I think that what that tells you is that the people who are playing this event are not the kind of, you know, are not the same players that you're going to get in, a WPT event or a World Series of Poker Circuit event. You don't have quite the same... stacked fields in HPTs. It's definitely local, weekend warriors. And I'm not saying that there is just going to be a bunch of bad players. Once you get to the final table of an HPT, there are going to be some legit guys there. But it's not going to be like the World Series of Poker or the WPT or HPTs at other, at other locations that are going to have stacked fields. This is going to be a pretty soft field, honestly. And if we look at the... if we look at when the event is going to be, it looks like February 20th is what we're looking at. That is, well, let's see, no, February, yeah, February 20th, right? 19th, 20th, and 21st. This is, you know, the dates of this, this is really why I think this tournament is just going to be such a good value for you, Bob, is do you know what's going on in the poker world around that weekend, February 19th, 20th, and 21st? Are you still with me, Bob? Or did I lose you? We lost Bob. I'm going to tell you guys what it is. We'll get him back here in a second. LAPC. The biggest one of the biggest tournaments of the year is going on. at the very same time as the HPT in Colorado, which means that all of the stone cold grinders are not going to be in Colorado playing the HPT. They're going to be in LA playing the LAPC. You know, it goes into that LAPC main event, the 10K. So yeah, I want Bob too, you an ass clown. I want him too. He's on his phone right now. We'll get him back. We'll get him back. So, that's right, J.D. Cole, we did meet at an HPT event over at the Stratosphere, and I've got to tell you, that Stratosphere, we sat down, we played, and that was a stacked table. You know, that I was looking around. There was Randy Ohl at that table. There were like three bracelet winners at our table, and that's how Vegas works. But you look at an HPT at Colorado, it's going to be a weak field. It's going to be a great value and a pretty big buy-in, $1,650. I'll tell you what, guys, while we wait to get Bob back on, let's talk a little bit about staking. I'm going to go ahead and lock in my piece of his package here. So tastystakes.com, it's not my site. I wish it was because it's really pretty. This is my favorite site for going and buying and selling pieces. I've sold a couple pieces of my WSOP action on this site before. You'll notice there's a nice little JavaScript going. Tastystakes.com is the address. You roll down here, just juicy stakes. Focus on crushing poker tournaments, not bean counting in Excel or Google Docs. Here's how it works. So when you sell pieces in an event, it becomes a real hassle to track who has what, to update all of your backers on how you're doing. So Tasty Stakes came along. The guy who put this together is a guy named Andrew Welch. He's part of the CrushLivePoker.com team with Hanson and Tuckman and a couple of those other guys. He put this site together. He's not making any money on it. It's a big labor of love. It's LinkedIn for tournament poker players. And look at this. And yes, it's free. So basically what you do, you put together your package, and it just has all these really pretty graphs and pretty reporting tools. And if you're selling pieces to more than two or three people, it's either this or it's some sort of Google spreadsheet or something, you guys. So tastystakes.com, I highly recommend it. Let's go over here to packages. And right now, since it's kind of a dead time in poker, there's not going to be a lot of packages, but we rolled down. There's six packages right now that we can choose from. That number will explode once the World Series comes along. But here it is, Bob Clark, HPT Colorado, Golden Gates Casino and Poker Parlor, 1650. He is selling this package, and look at that, 1.0. That is the markup. This is why it's a good deal, you guys, and this is why when Bob said that he was going to be selling pieces in this event and asked if I wanted to talk about it on the stream, I jumped at the opportunity because this is a good deal. I can honestly say that an HPT it's going to be a crapshoot, but it's a good value for somebody like Bob who actually takes his game seriously and focuses and tries to work on improving. He's watched this stream enough. He watches other streams a lot. He's watched the HPT viewing parties, every single one that we've done. And besides that, he's constantly working on his own game, playing with other people in Colorado, talking with some good players out there. So when he comes along and says, "I want to play an HPT, and I'm selling pieces at no markup," what that basically means is he's basically putting up X percentage of the buy-in himself, and then if you want 10%, you get it for $165. He's not upcharging you at all. So if he has any sort of plus EV in this tournament, then he's passing that along to anybody who books a stake. So if we click on his stake right here, we go to the package. You can view his profile. Has he filled all this stuff out? There he is, looking very royal, looking like a winner. He's got some, here's the references. Does he have references? No. But we know where he is. He's up there in Colorado. He's got the home field advantage. We go down here to package, total package, 1650, 30% of available pieces. That means that 30% has already sold out. And one thing I would suggest to you, Bob, if you're still, if you're watching this right now, is you should probably change this investor, instead of it being anonymous investors, you should go ahead and make it very transparent and public. The reason for this is because you want investors to know who else you're selling to, so that it's very easy for them to be able to compare notes and see that you're not overbooking yourself. So right off the bat, this is one thing that you can do just in your settings, is make it so instead of it being investor number two and investor number three, you know, number one, it goes by the pseudonym that they choose for themselves on Tasty Stakes. And that's going to, more transparency when it comes to staking is a must. You know, the poker world is so full of stories of people overselling pieces of themselves in tournaments. The most recent being the Kid Cardiff, who was a big name. You know, he was actually one of the Tournament Poker Edge pros, who did a lot of teaching on that site. He was very well connected in poker. One of his backers was Sheets, who was basically the godfather of staking. You know, he's had pieces of me since all the way back in 2004. You know, so I think we got him back. Bob, are you back with us? I can't hear you, but I can see you. So Bob's going to mime for us. And while he does that, I'm going to go in and I'm going to go ahead and book a piece. So you can read it, package info. Hello, my name is Bob Clark. I've been studying a lot of poker recently by watching Twitch. Shout out to Dutch Boy. Shout out to you too, Bob. Reading and playing in poker leagues in my town of Colorado Springs. Recently, I got first place in my Friday league. So, because my stunning hat collection and desire to go farther, I think we might hear you, Bob. I just heard a little crackling, a little bit of a mic crackling. It was close. It was close, Bob. He'll be back. We've got the video. We don't have the audio yet, but he's figuring it out. So, let's see. The buy-in is $1,650. He's putting up 10% of himself in the tournament. Why would someone do that? Why would someone want to play a $1,650 tournament and only have 10% of themselves? You know, with no markup. And why is he basically willing to work for free for you and me and anybody else who wants to book a piece here? I'm going to tell you why, okay? Two reasons. The first is exposure, and the second is experience. This is why, you know, if I was going to be playing some of the bigger tournaments like, you know, 25K Arias or 100K, you know, one drops and things like that, I wouldn't be selling markup because, winning these kind of events, having some, you know, TV exposure, that has some value, and then having the experience of these kind of events also has some value. So that's basically the trade-off. So JD Cole, is it Field of Dreams? Big Lebowski's in the stream. It's good to see you, man. He says this feels like an infomercial, but I'm buying one. Big Lebowski, it is kind of an infomercial, right? And if you act now, we'll throw in a fist bump patch and a free poker lesson with the Bob Hatter. No, you're not back with us yet, Bob. You know what? We can try shutting down the Hangouts and bringing it back on. I don't know. I'm a little bit worried about trying that, though. Can you hear me, Bob? I mean, like, are you hearing me on your side? Yes, he is. If you click on the Google Hangouts button, there's a little gear on there, Bob, that's the settings that a lot of times you can click on that and get your sound back. That's kind of what I'm thinking. Maybe you can do that and switch or something.
Does this work?
That works. He's
back. A little bit of an echo. My headset is going crazy on me.
Well, it sounds perfect from where we're standing. So welcome back to the stream. Welcome back to the stream. Poker Mindset Coach asking a little bit of an echo too, but that we'll live with it. Poker Mindset Coach asking, Bob, have you played any casino tournaments?
I have, and I've actually been doing fairly well in that area. I've cashed in a couple, got a couple first places, but all of them are not Hendon Mob worthy.
So is this going to be the biggest tournament you've played so far?
Biggest one.
Biggest buy-in tournament. Did you hear my advice about changing this right here to make sure that the investor list is public?
You want me to make the investor list public?
Yeah. Now, what it'll do is it'll show the investors as whatever pseudonym they want. But it's kind of important for investors to be able to look at the investor list so that they know that you're not overbooking, right? If you have these if you have these pieces and I can't actually see that there is a pseudonym behind it. You know, if I want to be anonymous as an investor, I can just make it so that my display name is anonymous. But as a player, you probably should be as transparent as possible when it comes to these kind of things, so that you don't have to worry about overselling or overbooking your action.
Done. The names are now public.
Okay. Let me see if I refresh it. If that worked, there it is. So we got Mark. We got Richard. I'm gonna go ahead and come on as well. And again, guys, if you're on Tasty Steaks and you want to be, if you want to have like a, you know, a little bit of anonymity on the site, you can do that just by changing your display name. Okay, so let me look in and look at the here is where you see what payouts he's accepting. A lot of people are going to accept PayPal over this kind of thing. I discourage it, and the reason is because there's been a few poker players who have actually had their PayPal account frozen and shut down for buying and selling pieces in poker tournaments. So if you look deep into the PayPal terms of service, it turns out that it's actually against the terms of service to use that, use PayPal to transfer gambling winnings and losses. And whether staking counts as gambling or not, whether it counts as a security or not, I'm going to leave that for another. That's another issue altogether. I'm not going to worry about it. What we are going to worry about is if we book this, how do we actually get you your money? And it looks like we've got three ways to do it. He's got this Venmo, which I believe is like a payment app where people get to, transfer money when like you go out to dinner or something with somebody. Is that what Venmo is, Bob?
Yeah, basically it's an option where you can give money to your friends easy online.
Okay. Then you got a snail mail, a check, or just cash at the event itself. I'm not actually going to be at Golden Gates Casino for this HPT because I'm planning on doing the LAPC, which is another reason why this is such a good value. I don't know if you heard us talking about the LAPC going on exactly when this is going on, but that's going to pretty much
hear that.
It's pretty much going to bring all of all the major poker players in the nation are not going to be traveling to Colorado for that weekend. They're going to be traveling to LAPC if they're going to travel at all. So this is a really good value, you guys. I can't stress it enough. There are not going to be the kind of, tough, like, soul crushers in this field as would be if it wasn't that weekend. If they even moved it like 3 weeks, then you'd have to worry about, a lot of those guys passing through. So it's kind of a dream spot and a dream date on the location where it's going to be a huge field and it's going to be just a bunch of people who, have normal lives and normal jobs and treat poker as a hobby and who are looking at, taking the weekend and saying, what are you doing this weekend? Do you want to go, you want to go skiing? You want to go smoke some weed? No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go play a poker tournament that's coming through. What do you mean a poker tournament? They have poker here in Colorado? Yeah, man. Golden Gates, there's a big poker tournament. There'll be 800 people showing up. It's like, oh, wow. So this is a good value, you guys. Let's figure out how to book the piece. And Bob, since I'm not going to be there, I can't do money at the event, and I don't have Venmo, I'm going to snail mail I'm going to do a money order. I'm going to just go down to Walmart, and I'm going to say, give me $165 on a money order, and I'm going to send that over to you. They have Walmart up there in Colorado. So that's going to work, right?
That is. They're actually the two Walmarts in Colorado that close. They're not in Colorado Springs. So that's good.
Okay, good. So we got a payment deadline, February 12th. Lots of time to do this. So let me see how let me book it. Book a piece right there. Piece I would like. Looks like we can go all the way up to 69.5%. I'm going to leave some for everyone else, and I'm going to take 10%. 10%? Maybe we do a little more. Gosh. I'm going to do 12.5%. And Bob, if I book this, do I have your word that if you do make that final table, not only will you be wearing a fist bump patch, but you will also be a special guest when we do the HPT viewing party here on Twitch.
Absolutely. And when I get first place, I'm going to do a shout out to you in the interview.
So there it is. Booked it. Book it. And it's booked. How awesome is that? So now we roll down here, do a little, it's refreshing. HPT Colorado, you own a 12.5% piece. You can see that right here for the Bob Hatter, a.k.a. Bob Clark. Payment deadline is 2/12/2016. I owe you $206.25 for my 12.5% piece. By the way, Bob, just to throw it out there, if you wanted to take Bitcoin, we could take this out right now. I don't know if you have a Bitcoin wallet or not, but if you wanted to,
I've looked at Bitcoin. I've never gotten to the wallet part of it. Plus, again, it's just transferring the Bitcoin to cash. I was confused. How can I do that quickly?
Yep, it's not easy. And you know, by the time I send $206, it could be worth $300 or it could be worth $70. So right. It's very volatile. But if you wanted to add Bitcoin as a payment option, I would be more than willing to do Bitcoin instead of snail mailing you a money order.
But so hey Dutch, I'm looking at chat and Ferrari Doctor says take 20%, he'll cover the other portion of it.
Take 20, I'll take the other half. Ferrari, look at this. It's filling up, Ferrari. So I don't really know. You're gonna have to do it on your own, Ferrari. and you can do it on your phone, man. Just load up your phone. Tasty Steaks plays really well on a mobile. So if you're watching this right now, just switch over, set up an account, and put yourself on the investor list, man. We got five people now who have picked something up. I don't see JD Cole.
I'm up to 47.5%, and JD Cole hasn't even put it in yet, and he said he's going to.
He's going to miss his window. He's going to miss his window because he goes, okay, I'm playing cards. I know you're playing right now, Ferrari. I know you got other things to do, man, but I don't want to be the middleman for this. part of this is you need to get comfortable with his Tasty Steaks site, man. It's the nuts. Let me show you what I've done so far, right? So if we go to my dashboard here and I look at my own history, so I've created one package on Tasty Steaks, only one. And for that package, everyone got a profit. There was an average ROI of 106% on the package that I created. And then if I go down at Steaks booked 3, Steaks completed 2, and you can see that my average ROI on Tasty Steaks as far as backing other people is a whopping 594%. I have a $312 gross, $267 net. And I know that is not a big number, but that's a big number. 594% ROI. I'm going to tell you guys, when you find somebody who takes poker seriously, is playing an event that has a good structure and a low rake and a lot of weak money, and you find that person who's going to be selling himself at face, that is a good bet. That's a good bet. So here we are booking another one. And Bob, I'm going to count on you to make sure that average ROI stays high. Okay, I need you to win this event for me. Can you do that, Bob? Because I really need the money.
I will win this event to keep you going.
So this is it. So there it is. It's booked. It's bought. It's not marked as paid yet. As soon as Bob, as soon as you get the money order, you go through your dashboard, and you click on your stake package page and mark it as paid. And then the cool thing is, I mean, it's really cool. You got the dashboard going. You can set your profile up. And if you guys are thinking about playing events and you want to try selling pieces, I encourage you to check out this site, tastysteaks.com. I'm not affiliated or associated with it in any other way except that I like what they are doing. It's basically one guy put this together, and it was a great service for the poker community, really. It's free, and it's pretty. And when I think about my own efforts with staking.com, this is basically what I want it to be. I think there's a lot of hurdles for actually trying to take a a helper app like this and actually make it into a real company. Because there's issues with staking. There's gambling laws out there. There's securities laws out there. So it's actually, what he's doing is providing a really useful service. But to actually, on his part, monetize it, it's kind of a legal headache. And you got a couple of sites that are trying to do it, like ustake.com, like pokermarket.com, globalpokerlink.com, there's chipmeup.com. There's a number of similar sites out there that are all trying to make a business out of helping you manage your stakes. And all of them, I'm telling you, all of them charge more than free and don't work as well as Tasty Stakes does. I wish that Tasty Stakes had a real nice way of actually handling the payment from me to you. But that puts them in an awkward position of actually, profiting from something that may or may not be legal, because I don't know. I don't know.
Hey, Dutch, Nine Iron had a question.
Okay.
He wanted to know, why does the total package say $1,650, even though people can't invest the full $1,650? And what it does is it counts the 10% that I'm putting in myself. So I'm trying to raise the additional 90% through people here.
Yeah. So you have 10% of yourself. You are, yes, putting up $165 of the buy-in, and that's why that number is what it is. But if you look at, let me get back to the packages here, and if you look at the Bob Clark package, which 63% is bought now, you guys. So if you want to get in on this, you don't have a lot of time left. But if you look at it, this is the number you need to look at, 1.0 markup. And yeah, it is a little bit confusing how they do it. Right, up to 90% available for sale, $1,650 in buy-ins. Amount booked is $948. Here's the minimum piece. Staking is a little bit confusing, but I'll tell you, this is what I can tell you guys. If you're buying a piece of a player at markup, then it's not enough for them to be a plus EV. They have to be enough of a plus EV that it covers the markup that they're charging you. There's going to be a lot of instances out there of poker players who are basically making a living not beating the game, not beating the tournaments, but beating the markup game, basically selling 1.1 or 1.2%, selling themselves at 1.2. If they sell enough, they don't even really have to worry about beating poker anymore. They're free rolling, basically. And there's going to be plenty of instances where a tournament poker player at the end of the year, it wasn't always like this. This is kind of a newer phenomenon, guys, but it's been happening a lot where at the end of the year, a poker player will actually be up, but his backers will all be down, except for a few of them who were able to luck out in the one or two tournaments that he actually had. This is kind of the movement that we've seen in the staking community, moving away from long-term makeup deals to markup deals. It's been pretty significant, and it's cleaner. I can tell you as a backer, I prefer just to do these one-off deals. What's a good markup? Well, the markup has to be tied to what you think your expected value and your ROI is in that particular tournament, which is really hard to nail down, especially live, where you're just not going to have the kind of volume to come up with anything. But I can tell you that there's been some kind of meta-analysis on what like a pro's ROI is at the World Series of Poker, and it's not that high. Like 21% is what like a pro's ROI is, and you compare that ROI with like what your average fund does on Wall Street, it's pretty good. A 21% ROI in a 3-day period is damn near impossible to beat anywhere on Wall Street, but it's a little bit underwhelming when you look at players who are trying to sell themselves at 1.4 markup, because in order for them to be able to show their investors a profit, their ROI has to be huge. I'll do a little poker clinic, by the way. Maverick BP, thank you very much. I'll do a little poker clinic, by the way, about how those numbers work out, like what a player's ROI would have to be to cover a 1.1 markup or a 1.2 markup. But for now, let me just say this: when someone is selling themselves at face value, when there is no markup, then it doesn't matter. You don't have to worry about it. You just have to ask yourself, is he plus EV or minus EV in this event? And if he's plus EV, then that's a good investment. You don't have to nail it down. You know, there's no longer a question of, well, is his ROI high enough to offset the amount that he's juicing me to take a sweat? There is no juice here, so it's pretty nice. Big Lebowski says 1.4 is incredible. They must be cheating. I think that there's probably some players out there who can command 1.4 big. Not me, but I think that, like, if Daniel Negreanu was selling himself in the main event at 1.4 markup, it's probably a good deal. You know, if Phil Ivey was selling himself in the main event of the World Series of Poker for 1.4, I would be a buyer there. But if Dutch Boyd was selling himself for 1.4, I think that I would probably pass. Honestly, that's just me. So, what do you think, Bob? You got any other thoughts before we turn to the actual structure sheet of this HPT and talk about why I love the HPT so much?
Well, here's the interesting thing. For giggles, I posted this page on my Facebook page. And what I did was a surprise. There was a guy that I haven't talked to in 2 years, gave me 10%.
That doesn't surprise me at all. Look how many people play the Powerball. You know, like, look how many people are, people love to gamble. People love the sweat. And this is a cool tournament to book too, because it's a televised event with a live stream. So if you end up getting to the final table, we all get to watch. We all get to watch and live, and it's going to be awesome. I really believe, you guys and Bob, I really believe that staking has the potential to fundamentally change poker. I really believe it. If staking became more mainstream, and your average person could buy a piece of their favorite poker players in the world's biggest tournaments, then I think that viewership and interest in the game would soar. And DFS was could possibly do that, because you're indirectly being able to have an interest, but staking is a direct interest. You know, it's like, I actually have a 12.5% piece now of Bob. And that is really cool. It's like, I'm going to be watching. It's almost like I am playing the event. You know, I'm going to be following you on Twitter. They've got, Tasty Steaks has all sorts of cool little management tools that I hope that you'll use, Bob, while you're there at the event. Every single break, just pop in your chip count. That's why we do it, for the sweat.
I'm very excited about this.
So let me think what else before we move on to the structure sheet. Bob, do you
I can shout out to some of the names here. I don't have people's usernames, but some of the people who donated to me.
Whoa. These are not donations, Bob.
I'm sorry, stakes. That's why I said stakes. It's a stake.
Yeah, watch yourself. If this turns out to be a donation, I'm going to be a little bit disappointed.
No, it's a stake. Sorry. There you go. So basically, Danny Foster, 5%. Derek Conley, 5%. You, 12.5%. Justin Cole, 10%. Mark Krenzer, 10%. Richard Bode, my friend, he did 10%. And Robert Blair did 5%. I mean, I already got 57.5%. Dude, you guys are awesome. Dude, seriously, fist pumps for the whole crew.
So that means you have 32.5% left to sell. I'm sure it'll sell. Let's focus. Let's focus on the actual structure sheet and get a game plan for how you're going to be playing this. Let me find this HPT coming up. So HPT Heartland Poker 2. I don't know if you guys heard.
Oh, one more thing. Ferrari Doctor wants to do 10% too. He just needs me to hold, basically reserve for him, and then he'll do it later. So that's what I'm going to go do. I'm going to change some of the settings.
You can do that. You can do that as an admin. You can add Ferrari Doctor, and then put that as.
I can.
Yeah, you can do that on your side.
Oh, there we go. Oh, I see that. That's cool.
Yeah, let's see if that works, Ferrari. Well, when you book that piece, Bob, then let me know. I'm going to refresh, and we'll make sure that Ferrari's on the investor list.
I just asked him for his email address.
Yeah, that'll work. So I don't know if you guys heard about this, but HPT has been going through a lot of changes over there. Did you hear anything about this, Bob?
You mentioned it on your stream that the CEO changed.
So Ken Lambert, who's a veteran of poker. I mean, he was working for Benny Binion back in the 70s. You know, that was his first job. And he's come through the ranks. I think he gave Jack Effel, who's now the World Series of Poker tournament director and, you know, director of all of poker operations at the World Series. I think he gave him his very first dealing job, you know, back in the 90s. He worked for Binion's Horseshoe when, you know, here in Vegas. And then when the Horseshoe went down, he went out to Tunica and was working the Horseshoe out there. He's very much an industry veteran and is one of the, you know, one of these core guys in poker that you don't really, you know, think of, but they have been pretty instrumental as far as expanding and forming the game that we play. You know, if it wasn't for the Kenny Lamberts of the world and, you know, the, who else springs to mind? Who's the guy who invented the super satellite?
You know, the guy that invented the table, the Lipsy cans.
Yeah, great example. What's his name? Henry Ornstein, I think. Lipsy, you know, if it weren't for these kind of background players in the industry, I mean, the poker world would not be here. It wouldn't be where it is, you know. So Kenny knows his stuff. They brought him on as the director of operations, and I don't know if it was his decision or if it went a little higher up on the Pinnacle ladder, because Pinnacle Entertainment is the parent company of Heartland Poker Tour. But they decided that they are going to move from Fargo, which is where, you know, Fargo, North Dakota, is where they're based right now, and they're moving to St. Louis. So they're moving the whole operation down to St. Louis. And as part of that move, they're basically getting rid of everybody. Derek Melliker, our longtime friend over there, is no longer going to be part of the organization. They got rid of all of their production team. You know, guys like Jeff Casper and Ooh and all the guys who are actually like behind the scenes sitting there every single day with After Effects or, you know, Adobe Premiere or Final Cut and the audio stuff. You know, and getting like designing the set and everything. They got rid of all of them, and they're moving operations down to St. Louis. What is it going to do? I have no idea. I guess they're putting together a new production team. Pretty much the only person from the current management team in Fargo that's going to be relocating to St. Louis, as far as I know, is Corey Stewart, who is their director of marketing. And, you know, Corey is pretty cool. I'll tell you, though, it makes sense that he would be making the move because he's from St. Louis. He's, he's homegrown right there in Missouri. And, you know, he moved up to Fargo to take the job. I don't think that he was really too enthusiastic about moving from St. Louis to Fargo. Even though Fargo is quite charming, you know, I'm not trying to dog Fargo, North Dakota. But it is out in the middle of nowhere. And there's, what, 30,000 people in the whole state? You know, it's like, you know, North Dakota, you know, switching from St. Louis to North Dakota is a little bit of a culture shock. So they're moving the whole production team back to St. Louis. I don't know what that's going to do to the actual show and to the actual company, but there definitely a lot of changes in store for the Heartland Poker Tour. Anyway, hopefully we'll still be, hopefully they won't give me a call tomorrow and say, hey, by the way, Dutch, you know those HPT viewing parties you've been doing on Twitch? We don't want you to do that anymore. Hopefully that doesn't happen, you know, because until I get told otherwise, I'm going to keep on doing them. And I'm hoping, Bob, I'm hoping that we're going to be doing one of your episodes before too long.
I hope so, too.
Yeah. So let's look at this. Golden Gates Casino and Poker Parlor, Colorado, the upcoming HPT events. Now, the HPT is kind of a poker series, right? They have, like, event number 1A, which is a $300 tournament, and they keep on going down, and they've got, like, a $200 tournament, and all these little prelims and everything. The truth is, you guys, the HPT isn't a series. It's this. This is the HPT, the HPT main event. Everything else, I mean, is basically just, you know, them trying to... they're there. They might as well do it, right? But no one's going to, you know, be taking time off of work to come and play a $300 tournament or a $200 tournament on a Sunday or, you know, a $200 no limit hold'em tournament on a Monday. This is probably the worst value in the whole series. A Monday event at noon. Who plays a Monday event at noon? retirees and career poker players and poker pros. Those are the two types of people you're going to run into. And I guarantee you that if you look at the rake on a $200 no limit hold'em tournament anywhere, and the HPT is not going to be an exception, it's going to be a prohibitive rake. It's going to be something like, you know, at least $30, maybe $40 just taken off the top for the privilege of playing that event. You know, it's kind of a perverse thing about poker in that the bigger you play, the less the juice and the vig is actually going to affect your ROI. And it sounds so weird, but in a very real sense, you can get to a point where you're playing so small in stakes that you are playing an unbeatable game. Not because the players are good, because they're not going to be, but because the rake structure or the juice structure in the tournament you're playing creates an unbeatable environment. That happens all the time here in Vegas. You know, where you're going to have a six, you know, all the time you have these $60 tournaments or $50 tournaments, and then you look at the juice and it's like, oh wow, you guys are taking $20 off of a $50 buy-in. Yeah, you guys are raking 40% off of this thing, and they're like, well, of course we have to. We got the dealers and everything, and it's, you know, you're basically paying $20 to play poker for, you know, hours and hours. That's a good rake. Well, no, it's not. I mean, it's a small amount, but when you compare it to the actual buy-in and realize, wow, 40% of the whole tournament entry fees are going to the house, and then when you do win, they're sitting there with their tip jar out, asking you to pay even more money. It's like, you know, it becomes impossible to beat. It doesn't even matter. You put, you know, Negreanu or Ivy in a $40 tournament. And yeah, those players are going to be bad that they're playing against, but if they're raking, you know, 20% off the prize pool, they're not going to be a favorite there anymore. There's just not enough left for anybody to have a positive ROI except for the tournament casino, like the actual house. And I feel like you start running into the, you know, that same kind of problem at like a lot of like the WSOPs. In the smaller events are really raked prohibitively. You look at the Colossus last year, and the big story was that Caesars actually raked more off of that Colossus event than first place got, which starts making me wonder if there really is even a positive ROI to be taken from that event. But then you start looking and thinking, well, 20,000 people, come on.
You know. Hey, Dutch.
Yeah.
Hashtag Swaggio has a really good question. He wants to know basically how people get paid when I win. And really, it's I mail checks.
You're going to mail checks, right? And yeah. If you win, if it's as much as the one in September was, where first place was $266,000, you're also going to have to mail tax forms, Bob. You're going to have to 5754 everybody. You know, if it comes to that, you're going to have to talk to your accountant and say, look, I need to get these 5754s or at the very least 1099s, because you can't be on the hook for 100% of the taxes on a $266,000 tournament when you only have 10% of yourself.
That's not a good ROI at all.
No. So, yeah, you're going to have to send out checks or money orders. And you're also going to have to send out a little 1099 or 5754. Okay. So this is the main event here, the HPT, and I'm looking for, I wish that they just had it so I could click on the event itself to look at the structure sheet. Looks like, click here for lodging, travel, and other casino information. I don't want to see other casino information, HPT. I want to see two things. I want to see what the structures are going to, what the structure sheet looks like, and I want to see what the juice is. I already know what the juice is, though. I think that they're juicing $150 off this thing. So it's a pretty big juice for a $1,650. But it's less than 10%. And as long as the juice is less than 10%, you can live with it. You know, the lower the better. And it's so weird, you know, like I was saying, where it's like this perverse little thing where, you know, you look at the biggest games and the biggest tournaments, and a higher percentage of the field can be plus EV, the higher it is, but it's so much tougher. Like the players that you're going to play with are going to be so much tougher in like a $10,000 tournament or a $50,000 tournament than they will be in a $500 tournament or a $50 tournament. But a bigger percentage of the player pool can actually, you know, expect to have a plus EV result because of the of the lower significance of the rake structure. And that's true in cash games too, where I'm not trying to tell you guys that a 5-10 no limit game is easier to beat than a 1-2 no limit game. But I can tell you that a higher percentage of the pool in a 5-10 no limit economy can be plus EV than in 1-2. You know, because the rake is pretty much the same. You know, and you start getting to like a 25-50 no limit game, that game is going to be really tough. You're going to be finding some of the best poker players in the world in a 25-50 no limit game, no matter where it is. But the rake is going to be pretty much the same as you're going to be paying in a 1-2 no limit or a 2-5 no limit, because they can't just keep on, they have to cap it. Otherwise, players balk and say, why would I be paying 10% no cap? Why am I giving you $300 for this hand? You know, so some casinos have tried, and they end up killing their games. Okay, so we found this.
I sent you the link for the actual structure sheet if you check your inbox.
I see it right here, the HPT structure sheet. So let me go ahead and see. Does that just bring it up? Yep, here we are, the main event structure sheet. Look at this, designed for you by Daniel Negreanu. Thank you, Danny.
Did you say
that? Yep. So what ended up happening way back in the day when the Heartland Poker Tour started? It started in Fargo by Todd Anderson and another guy named Greg. I'm having a little brain slip here, but Todd and Greg started the HPT, and the structure sucked. And one of the big criticisms they were getting from, you know, the Kesslers of the world and the Negreanus of the world was, this is a crapshoot. It's a joke of a structure where it gives you all sorts of play early on. So for the first 6-7 hours that you play this tournament, none of the pots mean anything. And then they switch to, you know, the late game where you might as well just all get, you know, in a line and flip a coin. You know, you might as well just, like, you know, pick a number 1 through 10, 7, you win the tournament. You know, a lot of tournaments go that way because what they want to do is they want to give the amateurs a lot of hours of play and kind of the illusion of getting some value. The idea, you know, the idea here is that if someone plops down $1,650 for a tournament and gets 30 minutes of play, then somehow that is not as good of an entertainment value as if they got 8 hours of play. But then once it gets toward the end, they just want it to be over with. You know, they don't want to have a final table that goes on 12 hours. They want it to be done. So a lot of structure, a lot of tournament structures are going to be this way, where early on it's actually like, wow, this is a pretty good structure. And then you get to the late, in the mid game and the late game, the bubble breaks and you realize, wow, everybody has 6 big blinds in front of them and this is kind of stupid. So the HPT reached out to they reached out to Kid Poker, they reached out to Daniel Negreanu, and they said, look, everyone's complaining about the structure, they're saying that we don't know what we're doing, help us out. And he's like, okay, let me design a structure for you. And so he did it. He designed for you by Daniel Negreanu, and this is the structure sheet that he came up with. And what ends up happening here is day one flight A, day one flight B. They have a couple of different flights for this thing. I think it starts on Friday, and they're going to have like 2 flights on Friday and then 2 flights on Saturday. And I talked to Bob and I said, look, if you're going to pick between those 2 flights, play the Saturday flight. And not only do you get the weekend warriors and the guys who have jobs playing on Saturday, so they're not going to,
why are you so bad over here?
Yeah, not only are you going to have a lower caliber of players on Saturdays, but you also don't have to worry about the guys who intended on playing multiple flights and already made their way into day 2. So the guys who are like the pro grinders who are playing well enough to make it into day 2, they're not playing your flight. So this is what I like about this structure sheet. So it's 40-minute levels on day 1, and then when it goes to day 2, you're looking at 60-minute levels. This is pretty comparable to a World Series of Poker structure sheet and time, guys. The WSOP is going to have 60-minute levels, and it's going to have somewhere around this kind of structure, where you look at you know, at any point in this tournament, if you look at the average chips, you're going to have more than 30 big blinds as the average stack. And it goes all the way through to the final table, where when, you know, every single time we've done an HPT viewing party and we looked at the lowest three stacks of the table, and it's like, oh wow, so the lowest stack of the table still has 17 big blinds. That's not exactly, you know, that's not exactly short stacked. It's not exactly a desperate situation. So yeah, by the way, Bob, I think what's going on with why you're so blurry is you probably have autofocus on. That's my guess. But that's what I think is going on, is your camera.
This is so embarrassing. Hilarious.
Well, you know, welcome to my world, Bob.
Yeah.
You know, this is what technical
training is easy. Anyone can do it.
All about. It's not easy. It is really, really hard. I can't tell you how many people are like, "Hey, Dutch, I'm gonna start streaming. Can you tell me why I keep on dropping frames?" And like, you know, hit up Twitch TV support, buddy, or hit up OBS support, because I can't tell you. I don't know why your camera looks crappy, Bob, but you look like a Monet. You look like you're like a French impressionist painting right now.
It's bad.
But I'm not gonna worry about it, because I'm focused on this. You can tilt all you want, but you take your technical tilt and you keep it.
That's what I'm doing. I'm taking it all for you.
JD Cole 72, he says, Bob, your camera is blurry.
Yeah, thanks, JD Cole. I noticed.
This is what I love about you, Justin. I love that comment, Bob. Your camera is blurry. I think I'm seeing a blur in your camera, Bob.
You know what? Just F it. We'll do it live.
Okay, so look at this. This is what I love about this structure sheet. Not only are the levels really long, 40 minutes on day one, that's fine. 60 minutes on day two, that's even better. So not only are the levels really long, so you'd never really feel like, oh, you're going to get blinded out of the tournament. You didn't even see it coming. But you look at the actual progression of the big blind, and it's always going to be real small little steps. You know, 10%, 20%. You never see a 50% jump. You're never going to see it go from, you know, 1,000, 2,000 blinds to 1,500, 3,000, right? Look at this. They could have done that, and they probably did at one point. Here they go from 1,000, 2,000, and instead of a lot of tournaments will go from 1,000, 2,000 straight to 1,500, 3,000. So all of a sudden, you know, the average stacks, you know, it jumps 50%, so everybody loses 33% of their effective stack, basically. Instead, they don't do that. Instead, they do a real small jump of, you know, from 2,000, you know, 1K, 2K to 1,200, 2,400. So it's a, what is that, a 20% jump? And then they do another, you know, what is that, 2,400 to 3,000. So I guess that's a 25% jump. And that's about as big as it's going to be, as a 25% jump. I don't think that there's anything more than it. Well, I guess this is kind of a big jump. This 3,000, 6,000 to 4,000, 8,000. That's a 33% jump. But they don't really have much of a choice, because what are you going to do? At 3,000, 6,000, then you're going to do a 3,500, 7,000. That doesn't really make any sense, right? So a 33% jump is kind of on the heavy side, but that's... there's just no getting around it. They've already raced off the 500 chips at this level. So, this is what makes a good structure sheet, a good tournament structure, is long levels, slow level increases. And the other thing that I really like about this structure is a lot of variance between this small blind ante ratio. And that's specifically what I want to talk to you about, Bob.
I'm listening, is
what that means for you and your strategy for this tournament. First off, before I even talk about, you know, an overall strategy, and every time I talk about poker strategy, I just want to point out, you guys, that we can talk strategy until we're blue in the face, but when it comes down to it, poker is a tactical game. Poker is not about strategy. Poker is about tactics. So keep that in mind anytime we talk about this stuff. You know, you are presented with a situation in poker, in particular a poker tournament like this, where we will never be able to recreate it. You know, Bob, every single hand you play in this HPT is going to be really important, and it's also going to be unique. There's never right. going to have ever been a hand like it, and there never will be again. You are presented with a single decision with a bunch of variables, an endless amount of variables that, you know, is asking you, Bob, what is the right move in this situation? And you have to navigate it, man. You know, and you know, there's going to be lots of times in tournaments where, you know, you're looking at something and you think that you can make a plus EV play, a plus ROI play. But then maybe if you make that plus EV play, maybe you're giving up even, you know, a future, you know, situations where there'll be even better EV, you know, or maybe you have to take the worst of it because you're never going to get something better than this. You know, you're going to have to navigate through this field, man. And it is a tactical game, a tactical decision. But let's talk about strategy. Before we do, though, do you feel like you have any leaks in your game?
I do, and I'm working on it. One of my big leaks is actually this happened at the Mid-States Poker Tour. I was in a satellite, and what happened was is basically I flopped the nut flush draw. And then what happened was is two people shoved on me, and I still called it and lost a lot of, you know, basically I got knocked out that way.
So they had you covered. So, one of these guys had you covered.
Yep, one of them had me covered.
And you had what? What was your hand?
It was ace of hearts, king of clubs, and three hearts came on the flop.
So do you remember exactly what the flop was?
It was king, 6-3.
So you flopped top pair with a flush draw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they both shoved on me and I went for it.
So not only did you have top pair of a pair of kings with an ace kicker, you also had the flush draw, the nut flush draw. That's never going to be a fold.
Bob. I called two shoves against me though.
It's never going to be a fold though. Like most of the time, when you know your pair of kings with the ace high is going to be fine. You don't even need to catch the flush. Worst case scenario is
they both have flushes like they did.
Yeah, that's the worst case scenario. And then you're looking at what? Five outs? Am I counting it right?
Yeah. So basically at that point I was hosed.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, with ace king off suit, hitting your pair of kings with the nut flush draw is usually going to be good. It's usually I would not suggest folding in that spot. I don't really consider that a leak. What do you guys think? JD Cole, you're listening. Do you think that was a leak? We'll find out. Maybe Big Lebowski thinks it's a leak. He wants his money back. He's saying that is a pretty bad leak. I think
he says that's good quality and the correct call.
Yeah, that's good equity and correct call. Of course, it turns out that it wasn't because he only had five outs. Am I counting that right? Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Yeah, five outs. You only have five outs. So that means you're 20% to win the hand against two flush draws. But that's not what they're supposed to have. One of them is supposed to have king, queen with a queen of hearts, and he's drawn completely stone cold dead. And then the other guy, maybe he has king, queen, two without the flush draw. Or maybe he has ace, king, and you're free rolling. Or maybe he has a flush draw, and you're looking at having, you know, seven outs or six outs. You know, maybe. Maybe he has a set and you've got all nine outs.
And JD Cole says, my leak is playing very aggressive from early position. And that's true.
I think that, you know, this is one of those funny things, you know, Bob, where I think that JD Cole, having, you know, he's played with you. He's watched you play. He's actually had a financial interest in some of your tournaments before.
Correct.
If you were going to try to get to the bottom of your game and think, what can I do to improve? What am I doing wrong? He probably can assess those leaks better than you can yourself. Now, there's definitely a self delusion aspect when it comes to poker that everyone falls for. Not just you. I'm talking about me too. You know, I know that I've got leaks, and I can't tell you what they are because I'm blind to them. You know, just
right.
like you know. just like everyone think, you know, everyone's the hero in their own story. Everyone thinks that they're, you know, that they're awesome. You know, but the reality is we are very bad at understanding, ourselves, man. It's tough. It's very easy to fool yourself. And I think that you should probably have a conversation with J.D. Cole before this HPT. You know, talk about what he thinks that you could do differently.
Better yet with Linda.
Actually, one of the things that J.D. Cole and I do that we're very serious about is every time that we do a tournament together, when on the drive back, we always talk about different hands.
That's good. It's important to have a good solid base of players that you can talk to about these kind of things, and talk to about specific hands, and even if you don't, you know, always agree on the right way to play a certain situation, that is how you grow as a poker player. So, you know, having that kind of support system is really important, Bob. Okay, let's look at this. This is what I'm talking about when I talk about the variance of this small blind ante ratio. When you hear people talk about changing gears in tournaments, what they're basically saying is that you have to change your VPIP in tournaments based on a couple of things. You have to change your starting hand requirements and your PFR percentages and your VPI percentages based on a few things. And all of those things collectively are what we call changing gears, right? Now, those things are going to be your own stack size, you know, and the effective stack sizes at the table. They're going to be psychological inflection points, particularly the bubble bursting and the final table bubble. And they're going to be the small blind ante ratio. You know, so when you think about what your ideal VPIP should be in a tournament, VPIP, guys, so we're all on the same page, voluntarily put percentage into the pot, voluntarily put money into the pot, VPIP. The percentage of times you've been dealt something that you voluntarily put money into the pot. Gosh, that is a clumsy acronym, isn't it? Like, who came up with VPIP? Why did VPIP become the way to express that? I don't like it. I wish that we had like an M. You know, we need Harrington to write another book, and instead of saying, you know, how many imagine if Harrington, instead of calling his M concept, called it your HM YF. You know, instead of M, we call it the how many orbits you can fade, HMOYF. What's your HMOYF in this tournament? Oh, I've got an HMOYF of 7. Could you imagine that? You know, so whoever thought VPIP was a good idea, that's how they probably would have expressed M. Instead of having it just be M, you're going to have the HMOYF. How many orbits can you fade? You're talking about M? No, I'm talking about your HMOYF. Your VPIP.
Why don't you just call it VIPIP?
The VIPIP. VPIP. So someone needs to coin something better. We'll leave it for another stream. But if any of you guys have an idea of what we can call it, I'm all ears.
Hey, Dutch.
Yeah.
I'm up to 74.5%.
Let's switch over. Let's see it. I'm going to refresh. You know, if you guys get in on this a little late, or if you're watching, on YouTube or something, 85% of available pieces have been sold, so there's only 15% left. Yeah, chances are, if you're watching this not live, you're going to be shut out of this. Too bad. You should have been following the stream and getting the notifications. Bob, I hope you win this thing. That would be so epic.
I do too. I promise to give you a shout out.
You know, we'll work with the HBT production crew too. So if you end up winning this, we'll have them actually cut like this moment into the actual television episode.
Yeah,
this would be awesome. So look at this. You got this small blind ante ratio that is all over the place in this tournament. Here,
right.
It's 100 small blind to a 25 ante, so you got a 4 to 1. Then the next level, when it goes to 150, 300, the ante stays the same, right? And this is probably going to be the case anytime that they increase the blind by that much. This is probably the biggest, one of the biggest jumps in the whole tournament. This 100, 200 to the introduction of the ante, and then 25, 150, 300. This is a 50% jump, but they kind of offset that huge 50% jump by not increasing the ante. And I have no problem with this big jump. You know what I do have a problem with is early stage tournaments where pots don't mean anything. You know, I actually think that, you know, starting off really, really early, just so that you know that everyone can have 2 hours of play, it's pretty hard to dump a 30,000 chip stack when you're playing 50, 175, 150. So these, these first levels are really kind of meaningless. I mean, you can go broke early on, but you should not. You should not. The ante kicks in here after 2 hours of play, 100, 200. I'm pretty sure that they start you with 30,000 chips, right? Is that what I was seeing?
Looks like it.
Yeah, look at that. Starting chips, 30,000. So when the antes kick in, you know, the average stack is going to be 150 big blinds deep. And then they have a huge jump in large blinds where now the average stack at level 5 is 100 big blinds deep. From then on, it goes pretty pretty slow. You know, but like so basically, this is when the tournament starts. Level 5 is when the tournament starts. And Bob, if you get knocked out before level 5, then I want to hear a bad beat story that involves set over set where you had the bigger set and after you got all the money in, the guy hit quads. Because that's pretty much the only way I can see getting busted out before this period, before the average stack is 100 big blinds. Now,
will do. I'll be playing some very tag poker.
Yeah, super, super tight early on because all you're trying to do is get into the cooler situation where someone else decides to donk off 300 big blinds with a king high flush. You know, you want to get into the cooler situation where someone else decides to donk off 250 big blinds with a set of threes on a 9-7-3 board. Those are the kind of spots you want to get into. You know, so, and I'll tell you, there's people who will look down at aces at the 100, 200 level without ante. They're going to look and they're going to have 150 big blinds in front of them and they're going to have aces and they're going to get three, maybe four big blinds in pre-flop and then they're going to get 146 big blinds in post-flop when they have their overpair. When it comes jack, 8-7 and they're not going to let go. You know, this is why, you know, this is why late regging, you know, isn't that great of an idea because there are players out there who will just never let go of an overpair, who will never let go of a set, who will never let go of a flush. And the fact that, you know, an opponent who has been playing tag and obviously isn't going to give away their stack now is willing to get 300 big blinds in, it never dawns on them that, oh, well, maybe my bottom set here is no good. Yeah. Okay, so this is when the tournament starts, though. Level 4, level 5. This is really when the tournament gets into gear, and now you play your normal way of stealing blinds and c-betting post flop, and sometimes making calls, you know, and sometimes making three bets and trying to correlate the kind of movements and everything that we've been talking about. But what I want to focus on is this variable of small blind to ante ratio. So here it is at 4 to 1. Here it is at 6 to 1, then it goes back to 4 to 1, then it's at 5 to 1, then it's at 4 to 1, then 4 to 1, then 5 to 1, then 3 to 1. This right here, 600, 1200 with a 200 ante, where it's a 3 to 1 ratio of the small blind. What this means is between level 10 and level 11, your VPIP should be changing. You know, when you look at this at a 500, 1000, let's say that we're still at the point now where, okay, so we're still at the point now. We've probably lost, we've probably by this point lost half the field. We're probably looking at an average stack of 60 big blinds at this level. And at a large blind of 500,000, maybe you're making it 2.25x. So maybe you're coming in at the 500,000 level, making it 2200.
Okay. Right.
And you're doing that. You're trying to have a VPIP at a full 10-handed table above 10%. The goal here is to take down just a little bit more than your fair share of the pots. You know, your idea. You're not trying to raise every hand. You're not trying to take a third of every single of all the pots. You're trying to take. If there's 10 players at the table, you want to take 12% of the pots, and that's it. So you're basically going for somewhere around, we'll say your VPIP is going to be somewhere around 14-15%. When the ante, when the small blind and ante ratio changes from 5-1 to 3-1, now you actually have to increase that VPIP pretty considerably. The idea here is, look at this level where it's a 5-1 ratio. You're firing in 2200 pre-flop and you stand to win 2500. That's a pretty good bet. If you can get away with your pre-flop open without having to see a flop more than 50% of the time, you only even need to get away with like 40% of the time for it just to be automatically profitable without counting any sort of c-bet opportunity post flop. Okay, and that's that's going to be the second time where you get just make this incredibly plus EV bet where you fire out half pot, and if you get through 40% of the time, it's profitable without even having to worry about sometimes you're actually ahead, sometimes you're able to take it down in a future street. Everything clear so far, Bob? You have any questions or anything?
Yeah. So basically, what you want me to do is open up a little bit more, and like the level 11, round 11,
mm-hmm.
or that basically when the small blind to ante is much of a small, much higher than it is in other levels.
That's right. Because look what happens. So you're making it 2200 at level 10 to win 2500. Right. At level 11, let's say that you're staying with the same 2.2x multiple. So at 2400, and then maybe you add another 300. So you're making it 2700, okay, at level 11. And I would suggest to you, Bob, before this tournament starts, pull out this structure sheet, print it out, or go to the casino and actually get it, and look at every single one of these. And for every single level, come up with an amount that you plan on raising for that level. So at the 100-200 level, maybe you're going to make it 500 here. And then maybe when the antes kick in, maybe you make it 550. And then maybe come up with your standard preflop open for each of the rounds.
Okay.
Before the tournament ever starts. And the idea is you're trying to taper it down so that once you finally get to the final table, which will probably be around... I guess maybe around level 21, level 22. Your final table multiple should be, it should eventually get to just min raising. So, maybe you taper down all the way to where finally, maybe at 4,000, 8,000, maybe you're making it 17,000. And then at 5,000, 10,000, maybe you're finally, you see that ratio goes, and you got to kind of judge how you're tapering down also based on that ratio. So maybe since the ratio's got even bigger, you lower it a little, that's where you lower it, right? So,
right.
Maybe it's 17,000 pre-flop at the 4,000, 8,000 level. Maybe you do a 20,000, and this level right here, level 20, is where now you're just doing min raises. 20,000, 24,000, 32,000, 40,000 until the rest of the tournament. But I would suggest, work it out for yourself and try to come up with something that feels good for you. The more comfortable you are with post-flop play, the lower your pre-flop multiple should be. Okay?
Absolutely.
And then what you should also be focusing on is your percentages need to be raised up a little bit depending on that ratio. So when that at level 11, when we go from a 5-to-1 ratio where you're making it 2,200 to win 2,500, and then it goes to this 3-to-1 ratio where there's 1,800 in the middle with the small blind and big blind, and then 2,000 in the middle with the ante. So what is that? 3,800 in the middle, and you're making it 2,700. So 2,700 right. to win 3,800. That's a much more drastic reward when you get through. So since it's a higher reward for when you get through, you need to try to get through more often. This is the idea of changing gears based on this ratio. So I would say, like, at a 5-to-1 ratio, maybe you're looking at a VPIP of around 14%. At a 3-to-1 ratio, you should probably be looking more at like an 18-19%. And, you know, adjust that.
Say that again at 5-to-1. I'm actually writing this down. 5-to-1, you said 14%.
That's pretty much what I would shoot for. And again, this is real, like, it's a little bit of we're talking strategy here again, when we really need to be thinking tactically, but yeah, and saying your VPIP doesn't really distinguish between a button raise versus an under the gun raise, you know, that all kind of counts. So when you're trying to actually do this in practice, it's not as easy as just saying, okay, I'm going to play 14% of my hands now, because it doesn't really work that way. You need to be playing, you know, you need to be playing tighter early on and looser in late positions when everyone has folded to you. But the general idea here is that, you know, if you were going to be playing a trillion tournaments and we were going to be looking at this stage of the tournament what your VPIP should be overall, I would guess it's somewhere around 14 to 16. And then at this stage, you know, for a good player, I would suggest that it'd be somewhere around 18 to 21. But, you know, in practice, how are you going to do that? You're not going to be able to do that. Just understand, or as Ben Carson would say, recognize that the ante and small blind, this ratio right here, needs to influence how wide open you are. Okay, so if it's a 3-to-1 ratio at level 11, or if we keep on, you know, if we fast forward a little bit to level 13 and we see about a 3-to-1 ratio, or we fast forward a little bit to level 18 where it's a 3-to-1 ratio, and that's as big of a ratio as it's going to be on this site. It's going to go between 6-to-1 and 3-to-1, and it's just going to mm-hmm. always be oscillating back and forth. Okay, the 6-to-1 ratio, you keep it kind of snug and tight. The 5-to-1 ratio, you keep it a little bit snug and tight. And if you're on the fence about, well, should I raise here or not, kind of on the fence, well, let that be your guide. 5-to-1 ratio, right. Fold. 3-to-1 ratio, raise. Okay.
Okay.
Look around the table and try to figure out who at the table is playing at that same level where they're going to even understand what changing gears means, and even and understand that they need to change their opening requirements based on that ratio. Most people aren't. You know, I'm not saying that this is like super highly, you know, this isn't like, you know, God level poker we're talking about here, but this is, you know, I would say more than just like level one thinking about this ante ratio and how it needs to affect your play. So look around the table and try to figure that out. And if you look at a couple players who you think are thinking of poker in high levels, and all of a sudden, you know, level 11 starts and this guy opens, You don't have to give him credit for a big hand. You can say, you know what, I think that he's opening because he's widening his range, because of that increased ratio. You know, a lot of times for a good player, when we reach one of these levels where it goes 500, 2500, and I'm watching like a good player during the World Series or a WPT or something, and I'm watching them and they're playing really snug and really tight, and then the levels are up. Dealers, the next finish the hand you're on. The next hand, we are going to 3,000, 6,000 with 1,000 ante. And I see him just kind of adjust a little bit, and a hand goes by and he folds. Another hand goes by and he folds, and now he raises. A lot of times, I don't even wait. I three bet it right there because I know that he knows that he's supposed to be widening, but I don't think that he knows that I know that he knows that. So he doesn't. You know, it becomes a leveling game. And a lot of times you run into issues when you give an opponent too much credit, but there's going to be some legit guys there. Just keep your eye open. Look for the people who are actually paying attention to what's going on around them. Try to get a feel for who might be thinking at that level, And don't be afraid to three bet if you have a reason, especially at those kind of those kind of levels where their VPIP should be higher. Don't be afraid to three bet the good players when you think that they're adjusting the same way that you are.
Right.
Pappas, good to see you in the stream, man.
I'll talk to you right here. I'm going to rewatch the replay just so I can definitely take some serious notes because I'm in chat right now talking to people.
Yep. So that's pretty much all I got for you, Bob. I'm hoping that this works out well for you guys. One more time, the package is on Tasty Steaks.
10% left.
10% left. So if you haven't booked by now, you don't have much opportunity to get in on the sweat. But there are...
10.5 because you did that 0.5 thing. I'll probably razz you if you can do it up to 13.
So, Bob, I wish you the best of luck. It looks like it's probably going to sell out here in the next little while. And, if it doesn't, feel free. You know, pretty much anybody with a sub badge next to their name is welcome to link out to whatever they want. I mean, that is one of the sub perks that we have in the channel is if right. you Nightbot will mute you pretty quick for typing out a link if you don't have that sub badge. But if you have a sub badge, by all means, you got something you want to promote, you got a link you want to send people to, keep it reasonable. I don't, don't spam every 5 seconds, go to my Tasty Steaks, but feel free, Bob, to go ahead and, link a few times, for the next few hours.
Right.
And if any of you guys ever have a Tasty Steaks that you are trying to put together, feel free. Please do mention it because I would like to have an opportunity to do more of these, to do more of these sweats. And we are building a community here together. So keep the money within in the community. And Bob, thank you for being on the show. You have anything else that you want to talk about or anything that you want to add before I
My mustache. It is amazing.
Is it a lucky mustache?
It is a lucky mustache. It's even got the little twirls on it.
Bob, I'm really wishing you the best of luck, man. I hope that you take this down. I'm looking forward to the sweat. The Bob Hatter, everybody. So
talk to you guys later.
I'm gonna shut this down, and we're gonna be bringing it back up for the Sunday grind. And what time is it? We're gonna be late regging this Disneyland tournament.
It's 4:15 your time.
I'm pretty sure that the Winter Poker Festival main event starts right about now too. So we have some big events coming up today. Hopefully we'll be able to keep the Twitch run good rolling after that win last night. So we broke our 2016 cherry, which felt pretty good. And I think that we're going to be putting up some big numbers. So guys, really appreciate you being here. Stick around because in 4 minutes we're going to be back. We're putting the delay on. And Bob, thanks so much for coming on and being a part of the Twitch community.
That was really awesome of you.
And guys, definitely check out his Tasty Steaks and follow him on Twitter at TheBobHatter. Anything else you want to plug and promote before we shut it down?
You guys should sub if you haven't subbed yet.
Thank you very much, Bob. I'll talk to you guys in a bit.
See ya. Bye.